Well, good evening and welcome to Greater Grace Church of Chester and Elsmereport. This is our evening, Sunday evening Bible study for our church. This is actually our last Sunday evening service of the year, just because of the way things fall. Next week we have our carol service at 11 o'clock, followed by fellowship lunch, followed by fellowship time. So come and join us for that if you can, live. In the evening we won't have anything because we'll have been at church most of the day. And also because it is the World Cup final, we don't want to distract from anybody who wants to watch that. It's going to clash with the Sunday evening anyway, so we like to accommodate these things for those who are into it. Obviously England is no longer in there, but still, you know, it is a world event. We are going to be opening God's Word tonight. Also, if you are available to sing carols, not this Tuesday, but the following Tuesday, we are going to sing some carols in the centre of Chester and just take the testimony of Christ into the city centre by the Christmas market. Very popular over the last few years for those of us who've done it before. So just reach my Bible. But it's always good fun and good life, so come in and join with us for that. That'll be about 5 o'clock in the afternoon on Tuesday the 20th, I think it is actually, isn't it? So a few things to be looking forward to for the next week. Christmas Day, we will meet at 10 o'clock in the church building. We'll just have that one service on Christmas Day, first thing in the morning, so that people who need to go places and be with family members will be able to do so. So tonight we're going to read, continue on the theme of the day. We're going to read from the book of Micah chapter 5. And it says there, "Now gather thyself in troops, O daughter of troops. He hath laid siege against us. They shall smite and judge, and the judge of Israel, with the rod upon the cheek. But thou, Bethlehem Ephrathah, though thou be little among the thousands of Judah, yet out of thee shall come forth unto me, that is to be ruler in Israel, whose going forth hath been from of old, from everlasting. Therefore he will give them up until the time that which travaileth hath brought forth. Then the remnant of his brethren shall return unto the children of Israel, and he shall stand and feed in the strength of the Lord, the majesty of the name of the Lord his God, and they shall abide. For now shall he be great unto the ends of the earth, and this man shall be the peace. When the Assyrian shall come into our land, and when he shall tread our palaces, then shall we raise against him 7 shepherds and 8 principal men." Okay. Let's also look at Luke chapter 1. We'll read a few verses from there as well, and it says, in verse 28, "Then the angel came unto her and said, Hail, thou that art highly favoured, the Lord is with thee, blessed art thou amongst women. And when she saw him, she was troubled at his saying, and cast in her mind what manner of salutation this should be. And the angel said unto her, Fear not, Mary, for thou hast found favour with God. And behold, thou shalt conceive in thy womb, and bring forth a son, and shall call his name Jesus. He shall be great, and he shall be called the Son of the Highest. And the Lord God shall give unto him the throne of his father David, and he shall reign over the house of Jacob for ever, and of his kingdom there shall be no end. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we just thank you, Lord, for these words that we've read tonight. Thank you for your goodness, your faithfulness, your life, your truth and all your ways. Thank you for your promises that don't fail. Thank you for your presence with us. Thank you for healing and life. Thank you for the finished work of Jesus Christ. We thank you for our Savior, for his coming, his miraculous birth, his prophecies that were fulfilled. We thank you for his life on the earth, his miracles, his testimonies, his teachings. But we thank you for his obedience and his faithfulness. We thank you for the fact that he went to the cross for us, that he paid the price for us, that he took every blame, every hurt, every wound upon himself. He took the responsibility and paid the price on behalf of mankind. And he rose from the dead and lives. He ascended into heaven, that he's at the God's right hand now. And then we thank you, Lord, that he intercedes for his saints. And we thank you, Lord, that he has promised to return. And Lord, we give you the glory now. And we worship you because you are worthy of our worship. You're worthy of our praise. And we ask now that your Spirit of truth and your Holy Spirit would anoint and fill us as we open this word together, as we seek to study it and understand it together. Lord, we are nothing in ourselves, and we need your guidance, we need your wisdom, we need your Spirit of life. But Lord, we thank you that you have promised to send your Holy Spirit. And we thank you, Lord, that you are faithful to pour out a blessing on those who desire to know you. Our heart is to know you now, to understand you. Fill us with your Spirit and anoint every word and every utterance from your throne, Lord, by the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. Okay, so tonight, just as we look at these prophecies again, we were also reading Isaiah 9 this morning, but interesting, this prophecy that is thousands of years, hundreds of years in the making, hundreds of years coming to fruition, that thousands of years ago from now, but Micah speaking. It's interesting, the book of Micah, because you have prophecies about what was going on then, and particularly regarding the Assyrian invasion of Israel, the northern kingdom, but also referring to the Assyrian attack on Judah under the time of Hezekiah. And you see actually how God faithfully came through. All these things are prophesied there. But in amongst those prophecies that came true within people's lifetimes, there were also prophecies of things that were to come true hundreds of years later. And we have this famous, well-known prophecy because it speaks about Bethlehem, as we said this morning, an insignificant place in Israel, but significant in the kingdom of God, significant in the plan of God. Many famous Bible characters associated with this small village. But yeah, God came through with this plan. Out of thee shall come forth unto me That is to be in a ruler in Israel whose goings forth have been from of old, from everlasting. It's interesting there as well, because we see there not only the foretelling, the prophecy of Jesus' coming, but there's also in those few words something else very significant is pointed out, that the one who was to come was from of old, everlasting. Now we are all okay with the idea of Jesus being on the earth and going forward, rising from the dead and ascending to heaven and being eternal that way. But it's very clear that this is talking about the Godhead. Why? Because it says from of old, everlasting. In other words, eternity in the past is brought into this prophecy here. So when the Spirit of God speaks to Micah, he's saying, actually, the one who comes will be Messiah, the one that you're waiting for, the one that the Jews have been prophesied for a long time and are expecting to come as a victorious conquering hero. But not only that, he's going to be God himself, because he was eternal in the past. This has got to be somebody who was there before creation. There's only one that this could be. It has to be God himself. So actually, it's a way of ensuring that the Lord Jesus Christ was the divine creator. He was there. Last week we were focusing on John chapter 1, how the Word became flesh, the one that all things were made by him, and without him was not anything made that was made, the Creator God. Again, it's all very clear if you look at the Bible that Jesus is God. There's no way around it, that he has the life force in him, that he is the Creator. There are many groups out there that say, oh, Jesus was just a man. He was just a good prophet. He was just a good teacher. But no, the Word of God, if you believe the prophecies that are there, and they are there, they tie up with the historical facts, so we can't ignore them. But if we take them at face value, what they're saying is that this is God in human form coming down, the one from eternity past. And he's, as we were emphasizing this morning, his kingdom is without end. His kingship is sovereign. He's there to be a ruler in Israel. He's there to be the Son of the Highest, as the angel told Mary. I was going over this morning how so many of the prophecies and so many of the things that the angel said were exactly the same. The same written in Isaiah, the same written in Micah, and we see it again and again, that every prophecy of the Messiah is echoed by the words of the angel and the words of the prophecies in the New Testament before the Lord Jesus Christ was actually born. God's word is not changeable. God doesn't alter the details or change his mind. He said the same thing via the angel to Mary, as he had spoken to his prophets those hundreds of years before. It's like, wow, this is our God. The increase of his government, there will be no end. His kingdom is forever. He said this morning, this man shall be the peace. Verse 5, we read that this morning. this man shall be the peace. And that is who the Lord Jesus Christ is. We were discussing as well in our wrap after church this morning a little bit about a friend of mine at work who actually said, oh, I have some friends who are humanists. And you think, well, that's great, that's nice. But humanism, there's no peace in it. There can never be any peace in it, really. I can be humanly good. I can be good without God. I don't need God. The secular world loves to take this stance that actually we don't have need of a God. We can be good in ourselves. But actually, this is the tree in Eden, the knowledge of good and evil, the one that Adam and Eve partook of that caused the sin. Good and evil were part of the same tree. That's not the issue. The other tree was the tree of life. And trusting Christ, knowing God's heart, receiving life, that is the real issue. Not a measure of how good we can be, how bad we can be. Now, in humanism, there is a measure whereby we can try and be good. But the danger is that actually, can we have any peace? Have we ever been good enough? Well, either we pat ourselves on the back and say, well, I'm sure I have been good enough. But how do we know? Who do we measure it against? There's no real resolution there. There's no perfect measure. What people think, what I think, what other people think, what if people have a different opinion, what if people have a different standard? There can't be any peace there. And the Bible says actually Christ is peace. And knowing him is peace. What happens when we fail? Well, again, if our standard is just human goodness and how good I can be, then again, there's no peace. It was interesting, something that Pastor Shallow was saying today as we listened to a service in Baltimore. He was saying about how, you know, like, you get in the world, you get one pronoun wrong and that's it. There's no forgiveness. There's no, well, you said the wrong thing. You made the wrong, we looked at your social media accounts, and actually 5 years ago you told a joke that was politically incorrect. Oh, and now you're going to be cancelled. There's no forgiveness, there's no mercy, there's no way of dealing with it. It's just, that's it. It's over. This is what the secular world does, this is what humanism does. It's like, well, there's no way forward. But a saviour, who is Christ the Lord, a saviour coming to lay down his life and bring us forgiveness that we couldn't attain to ourselves. This is peace. This is why it says, this man shall be peace. This man shall be the peace. That with the Lord Jesus Christ, there's a sense that whatever we've done wrong, we will do things wrong. We do things wrong all the time. We're weak, we're failures, we make mistakes. And we readily admit it, you know. We say the wrong thing to people, we upset people. We upset ourselves sometimes. We let ourselves down sometimes. But actually, we can go to a loving Saviour, to an eternal Father. And we can say, Lord, the sacrifice you made for me, I need. to know that it's real. I need to know that it touches the things that I've done. My failings, I can bring my weaknesses, I can say, Lord, change me, heal me. I repent of these things, I bring them to you, I don't want them anymore. Forgive, heal, and we are told in God's word that he is faithful. We confess our sins, he is faithful to forgive our sins and cleanse us of all unrighteousness. So there is peace. There is a knowledge that there is going to be forgiveness. There is a way forward. This man shall be the peace. And also because we have a Father who is everlasting, his kingdom, he shall reign. His father David, the throne of his father David, he will reign and continue to reign forevermore. So again, our future is secure. What's going to happen? We were touched by the testimony of Bukayo Saka, the England player, who said that he reads his Bible every night. He prays to God every day, and he doesn't worry about the situations that come. He just gives it all to the Lord and trusts him, because that's all we can do. And when this life throws things at us, you know, when disappointment comes, like last night for the England team, where do we go with that? It's like, well, we have a Savior. We have one that we can trust, someone we can go to. When the eyes of the nation are looking on us with expectation, it's like, well, there's still somewhere to go. There's a Savior. And the other thing that really struck me, going back to the subject of these people that were, that call themselves humanists, is that when suffering comes, where do we go with that? If a problem comes, a sickness, an illness, a worry, a concern, a crisis in our life, what do we do? Well, we find a coping strategy, and maybe we find a medication, and maybe we find something to distract us, and maybe we got. But actually, it doesn't take the things away. When there is a deep wound, when there's grief, when there's pain, when there's suffering, what can we do? Well, we see time and time again in God's word that God allows situations for us to draw near to him. We're told actually that if we trust him, if we believe in him, actually we will suffer. Suffering is part of the deal for a believer. We will suffer persecutions, but we may also enter into the sufferings of Christ that we might know him. Remember that. Paul says that in Philippians, that I might know him and the fellowship of his sufferings. So actually, suffering in this life is a way for us to grow closer to the Lord, draw near to him. Suffering in this life is a way for us to discover God's faithfulness in a very intimate and personal way that we never knew before. When we have a deep challenge, when we have a major worry, where, what do we do? Do we go to God? Do we trust God in prayer? This week I was telling somebody, actually this morning, that somebody was saying they may have to go into hospital, they were worried about it. I said, well, pray. And I was able to give three examples this week of different situations in our church where we prayed specifically and God came through. All this is happening and we need to pray about that. We'll pray about that. And God came through. And sometimes for other people, for friends, for work colleagues, for various people around the world, we just gave it to the Lord and the answer came. And it's not because we are wonderful Christians or anything like that. It's because we have a great God. Now, we don't get every answer to prayer that we would like, but we always get an answer. Sometimes the answer is no. But we give the burdens and we give the cares to the Lord. And there is a way forward. But to somebody who lives in just human goodness where there is no God, actually suffering is pointless. It doesn't do anything for us. It doesn't help in any way. It's just an unnecessary, depressing burden. There's no good that comes out of it. But actually, really, for somebody who's only living for this world, the whole of life could seem pretty pointless. But the Word of God tells us that no, we have a purpose. God made us. He loves us. He loves us enough to send His Son into the world. This is why we celebrate Christmas, because it's the gift of the Lord Jesus Christ to the world. It's seeing God faithful in His promises and faithful to the prophecies, sending His Son to rescue us. It's God in His promises. It's God in His faithfulness. It's God in His character. Everyone in this world is precious. I was able to say that to a young man today when we were on outreach this afternoon. Actually, you know, God made each one of us. I think he had a disability. I wasn't sure. I didn't manage to speak to him for long, but you know what? It's interesting that sometimes the world will write people off. But no, to God, every life is precious. Everyone has a portion. Everybody can be used by Him, and He has a purpose for every life. He doesn't create people by accident. He doesn't create people for no reason. If you are on the earth and you're alive, God wants you here. That's a very important thing for us all to remember and for us all to know. And we can be part of something that God is doing. And we can trust Him. And we can discover Him. And the beautiful thing is, as well as we were saying a few minutes ago, that actually His kingdom is without end. This is the promise to Mary. This is the prophecy that Micah had. This is what Isaiah said also. That actually the Messiah comes. Something starts on the earth with the birth of the Lord Jesus Christ. But it never ends. It never ends. In fact, it didn't really start with His birth anyway, because as we said before, this was the God of eternity past, from of old, everlasting. That's what it says in Micah, the God of eternity past coming to the earth. But actually the kingdom is without end. Our future will be secure. Our life, however long it may be on the earth, is not the end. There is something after. There is an eternity future as well. And actually, our opportunity to worship God now extends into the future also. That there is a day when we will stand before the Lord. Whether it's because of Christ's return, or whether it's because we pass through the veil of death, but every one of us will stand before the judgment seat of Christ, as it tells us in 2 Corinthians 5:10. And it's like, yeah, every one of us will be there. But God gives us the opportunity to know Him now, to have that relationship with Him now. We can start something now in our life that will continue forever, and that's a relationship with the Lord. And if we've never done that before, it's time we did it. But if we've done it, you know, it's something that started, we have a start date. Many people can tell us in our church, we'll be able to pinpoint the day when they trusted the Lord Jesus Christ for the first time. But actually, the amazing thing is that that was the start date for them of something that will last forever. Our time on the earth may be short, may be long, but our time in eternity is forever. Praise the Lord. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we just thank you, Lord, that actually you give us that amazing opportunity. You give us that incredible promise of faithfulness, that the Lord Jesus Christ was to come to the earth, that he would live on the earth, that he would go to a cross, that he would die on that cross, that he would pay a price for mankind, but that he would rise from the dead and live forever in heaven as the Godhead, as the Son of the Highest, on the earth and in heaven, and that he would be our peace. Thank you, Lord, for coming to be our Savior. And thank you, Lord, that we, every one of us on this planet, have the opportunity to start a relationship with the Savior that continues forever. Not just for a short time, not just for the period that we go to church, not just for the period that we are able to stay faithful, not just for the period that we feel in that emotional mood, not just for the extent of our earthly life, but a relationship based on love that is forever. Thank you, Lord. We worship you and we thank you. Thank you for your faithfulness throughout this year as we have our final evening service of the year. Thank you, Lord, that you have been faithful to us every night. Every night as we lay down to sleep, every morning as we woke up, we thank you for your faithfulness. We thank you for your love for us. And we thank you, Lord, that when we go through things, we have somewhere to go. We have a meaning. We have a point to this world. We have a purpose. We have a calling. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord, that you are very real in our every situation. And Lord, we pray if there's anyone out there who's never trusted you as their Savior, but who wants to tonight, we just pray that this would be the time when they say, Lord, I need peace. I need you to be my peace. I know that there can be no real peace without you. I understand that. I understand my failings, my weaknesses, my wounds, my sins. But I understand that you took them. You died for them. They were buried with you. And that you offer me eternal life from your kingdom that is without end. Thank you, Lord, that I can enter into a relationship that is forever. Very few things in this life last forever. But a relationship with the Lord Jesus Christ is one. Come in. and in my heart be with me, hon. Help me to understand and know you. Teach me your ways. Fill me with your spirit. In the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. Well, it's been a strange year, an unusual year, a lot of differences, a lot of changes, but a lot of blessings. See you again, hopefully, online on Sunday morning next week for our carol service. Come in person, even better. Come and fellowship with us. We would much prefer to see people in person and to see them online. But come and join with us, celebrate our Savior and our God with us. Take care, God bless, and see you soon. Bye for now.